I'm Jeff Cote with Pacific Yacht Systems, and I'm a really big enthusiast on electrical systems. I've made a living from boat marine systems, and today what I'm going to share with you is really the common experiences or all the leveraging all the things that I do on boats. Not just myself anymore, because we've got a dozen people that are part of the team. And last year we worked on over 600 boats, and we helped owners make their electrical systems better. So what I try to do when I do this sort of presentation is try to leverage the experiences that we do helping other boaters and translating that into common products that are really popular that we use often and repeatedly with other boat owners to solve something that, the problems might differ, but all in all, there's a lot of commonality between all of us out on the water and what we try to do. And what these products are going to be talking about are common ways of solving problems that we see out on the water vis-a-vis electrical systems on our boats. Because of the format of the presentation, if anyone has any questions, feel free to raise their hand. And also, I want to emphasize that there's feedback forms at the back of the room, and the boat show people really like for you to hear back from all of you. So take the time to just say good, bad, yay, nay, whatever it is, feel free to give your feedback. So what's the format of the presentation? What I'm going to do is we're going to talk about 10 different products, and how we're going to look at that is we're going to look at every single product in three different ways. The first is going to be what and why. What's the product and why would you want one? And then the next step is, once you figured what it is and why you want one, is, well, how do I go by buying that product? What should I look for? Because those products comes from multiple vendors, and make sure you don't buy a product you don't actually need. And then lastly, the third slide on every other product is going to be pitfalls for installing that product on your boat. Because it's really essential to read the instructions. And sometimes the instructions, I mean, they tell you everything, but there's certain parts of an installation of a product that are commonly omitted that might give you troubles, or the product might not work as well as you thought it should, just because you missed a certain installation step that's going to make a big difference. So first and foremost, what I always emphasize to all boat owners that actually want to leave the dock and decide that they're going to go anchor at least overnight, one night, or even maybe go for a lunch hook, but generally at least one overnight. And from there, it could be some people are gone for 3 months, right? They might only see shore power every 2 weeks, every week. But the moment you decide that you're actually not, you're going to take your boat and you're going longer than a day sail or day boating, and you're going to stay at an anchorage for an extended period of time, even an overnight, a battery monitor is a really good thing to consider for your boat. We probably sell over 100 to 150 of these devices a year. And why I'm so emphatic in for boat owners to get it is it's a fuel gauge for your batteries, and allows you to understand the depth of discharge for how much you have left in your batteries. And it translates battery capacity into percentage. So it's way better than voltage. Voltage is a crude indication of capacity. It's a way for you to know if you're in the ballpark. But if you want to actually know exactly where you are, you need to have a battery monitor. And the other thing too that I really like about a battery monitor is it also tells you the rate at which you're depleting your battery bank. Right? The rate at which, if you've got a power boat, if you're going really, really fast with your power boat, your range is going to be limited, right? Because you're burning a lot of fuel quickly because you're going fast. Batteries are actually the same way. The faster you deplete your batteries, it's not a linear thing like fuel. Fuel distance and speed are not a linear correlation. You'll go much further with a powerboat if you go slower. Not only the time it takes you, but you're gonna go much further. Same thing with our cars, fuel economy. If you're driving your car at top speeds and you're in an autobahn, your range would be limited because in the top end, you're actually burning more fuel. Your batteries are the same way. So what's interesting about that is it takes that into consideration. And as a boat owner, you always want to be modest or thoughtful in your consumption of power. It's a little bit like money. It's very rare that I meet a boat owner that tells me they have too much power. I might, if I do 600 boats in a year, I might meet five people that tell me I don't worry about power. Even boat owners that have big boats, like 80, 90 footers, worry about power. We all worry about power, like most of us all worry about money to some extent. And a good way to solve the money equation or the power equation is not just make more of it, but to not waste power. And a way to not waste power is to know how to meter it. Quantify what you're doing. Get a feedback for what you're taking and start reducing loads. Like one thing that's always shocking is engine room lights. Engine room lights are one of the things that are often not changed to LED. And you'd be surprised, some engine room lights, when you have those breakers on, and you might not be in your engine room, you're up on in the flybridge, and you left the breaker on, it might draw 10 amps, right? Now you've got 10 amps, and you might forget that they're on, because you're not going in the engine room. 10 amps for 24 hours, that's 240 amp hours. That's what a big boat budget in total of amp hours is for a day. And just wasted for having four or five engine room lights being on when nobody was down there to actually need them to be turned on. So an amp meter is a good thing because it tells you, over time, you get a sense, what's normal on my boat? What should I be using at this given time? And then you realize that you need to curb your consumption to maximize the amount of time you can stay at anchor, right? If you're gonna buy a battery monitor, you want to make sure that it has a really good size shunt, which at least 300 amp shunt. You want to get a battery monitor that's going to show your battery capacity is in percentage. And that's essential because that really takes away the whole calculation thing. I'm an engineer and I love math and I love doing fractions and multiplications and all these weird things, but most of us probably don't want to do any of that. And like a fuel gauge in your car, it doesn't tell you how many gallons you have left or how many gallons you've taken. It gives to you that in a fraction. You have half a tank left, an eighth of a tank, a quarter of a tank, right? It's doing the calculation for you and it's saying, I'm gonna show you a fraction. And a fraction and a percentage are similar. And then that way it's readily understandable to everyone. I'm at 75% of capacity. You don't need to be an electrical engineer to know what that means. But if I tell you your minus 214 amp hours, you're like, well, what's minus 214? Minus 214 of what, right? Because you need to know what your overall capacity is, and then you need to readily be able to do the calculation in your mind. Percentage will just make that easy. Popular models that we really like are the three that I indicated. The Victron and Xantrex, Link Lite and Link Pro are very, very popular. I'm starting to be fond of the Blue Seas M2, a little bit more money. But what I like about the M2 is that it actually shows you in one glance everything you need. So it's going to show you your primary battery voltage, secondary battery voltage. It's going to show your amp hours and amp hours as a percentage. It's going to show your amps. So you don't need to actually engage the battery monitor to flip through the pages. What I always find is people are inherently lazy. And if you're looking at your battery monitor and it's showing you volts, and you're maybe in the cabin and you need to stand, walk over to the display, press a button to go see amp hours, you might not do that as frequently as you should because it means that you have to stop doing whatever you're doing and get that information. If you can simply glance at a screen and it tells you everything you need to know, because the screen is bigger, right? And nowadays, bigger screens are not that expensive. That's great, because at one glance, your brain is gonna process four pieces of information that you see on there, or you'll look at what you need to look at, and you'll know that you'll be good to stay overnight, and the next morning, your inverter won't be beeping because you've got low batteries. Battery monitors are really suited for deep cycle applications. So what that means is if you have a battery bank set up where you have house batteries and engine batteries, you really don't need a battery monitor for your engine batteries, right? Because your engine batteries are something that you use just to start the engine. And in our cars, and I would say even in the big boats, I mean, I get a chance to work on mega yachts, well, I don't know, maybe 140, 125. And even in those boats, they don't put battery monitors on the starter batteries. Because a starter battery is not used as a deep cycle application. It's simply used to start the engine. So it starts from 100%, and it goes to 99%, 98%, and it's charged again. And if you do that with your engine battery, you really don't need to know how low the percentage is going to go because you're never going to use it in that application. So that's a good news because it means that realistically, for most of us, we only have one house battery bank on our boat. Maybe some of us have two, but that's more of a legacy type of electrical system. And so you can have with one battery monitor, that's the only battery monitor you need. The other thing that I try to highlight here, which is really important, which is the shunt captures all the current going in and out. A battery monitor measures current going in and out of the battery. And that device that does that is called a shunt. Now, here's the gotcha. A battery monitor is not this God device that knows everything that goes in and out of the battery unless it measures it. So, you're going to install a battery monitor on your boat. You do everything by the book. Everything's amazing. Nothing bypasses the shunt, meaning nothing is not counted. Everything going in, everything going out is captured. Now you hire someone to come work on your boat. That person is, for example, a hydronic heater specialist. In the manual, it says, I want the hydronic heating system to be directly connected to the battery. The specialist is going to say, I will follow that to the letter. They're going to connect the power leads, both the positive and negative, to the battery. Now, what the installer of that didn't realize is you have a battery monitor in your boat, and that battery monitor now doesn't see the current going in and out for the heater because the negative was connected directly on the battery, not before the shunt, right? So suddenly, it's like counting cars on a bridge, and you forgot one entry point onto the bridge. So there's cars that are getting onto that bridge that you're not counting. And so suddenly you have a heater system that is miraculously doesn't take power. Your heating system is so amazing that it can run forever and it never draws any amps. But weirdly or oddly, your batteries don't last as long. Because it doesn't make sense. My batteries don't last long whenever my heater's on, but my heater doesn't draw any power. Right? And so these two situations are mutually non-exclusive. They're related. You're only getting half the information. That's why your batteries are actually getting depleted because the batteries are running the heater in part, but your battery monitor isn't. So if you have a battery monitor on board, it's quite common that the shunt is at the wrong location. Maybe not initially badly installed, but over time as people are adding circuits on your boat, they forget to go after the shunt, they bypass it, and all those new loads like your downriggers, maybe your fridge, your deep freeze that you ran directly to the battery are now not counted by your battery monitor. Battery monitors never lie. I've never seen one fail. If it's defective, it's an installation problem. I mean, every rule has an exception, but if I've never seen the problem, it's very unlikely that your boat has a problem. Don't look for the battery monitor to blame or find an excuse for the problem. Look in the installation. That's probably where the issue is. And it might you might have done it properly, but someone else that came on board bypassed it, and now you're not getting the full readings. And the really important thing at the bottom and what I'm trying to highlight here is you've got to make sure that you configure the amp hours capacity. A battery monitor doesn't really know what's in the battery. Remember, what it does is it counts everything that goes in and out. So it's like an accountant that starts counting all the transactions going in and out of your bank account. But what you have to tell the accountant is, how much money did I have in the account when you started counting? Because it doesn't actually have counting constantly the money that's in the account. It says, I had $1,000 in the account, start counting. I took $10 out, added 20, took 30, took 30 again, added 20. It doesn't need to weigh or count the money in the account. It knows how much was there initially, and then it's counting every transaction in and out. And that's what really a battery monitor is. It's really another, the right term for it, it should be a battery counter. It counts transactions in and out. So if you don't configure the right amp hours, and you tell your battery, because they're always default as 200 amp hours, if you didn't configure the battery monitor for 600 amp hours or 1,000 or 800, the battery counter, battery monitor, is going to give you wrong fractions. because it really doesn't understand the numbers. And you'll be maybe in the negative, but your batteries are still good. So you want to make sure that you always configure the right battery amp hours. And on more modern models, because now there's a lot of different battery chemistries out there, also the battery type. And I spend a lot on battery monitors because I really believe in them. It takes the whole magic out of batteries, by the way. Electrical systems are reliable if you have them well diagnosed or monitored, and it's quite predictable. So the battery monitor will take out this whole magic of electrical systems, and that's why I like spending a lot of time on that. The next thing is an inverter charger. What's an inverter charger? An inverter is a device that converts DC power to AC, and a charger or a converter is something that converts AC power to DC. So it's kind of like inverters one way, chargers the other way. People put inverters on their boats to run AC outlets, predominantly like a microwave, maybe an espresso machine, a TV, a hairdryer, any sort of a Bose sound system, anything that generally connects into our homes, right? So creature comforts that we're familiar in our house or in our homes are going to be run off an inverter without being connected to shore power or having a generator on. And the other thing too that's nice about an inverter is, especially when you get a 2,000 watt inverter or a bigger inverter, you start having a really good charge rate, right, as an added bonus. So you can get a 2,000 watt inverter with a 100 amp charger, or a 2,800 watt inverter with a 115 amp charger. We'll talk about that later, and that's really relevant. As our battery banks are getting bigger and bigger, you always need to have lockstep your charger rate with your battery bank. Those two things need to sync, and we'll talk about that. All right, this is really critical. I can't tell you the why if you want, because it'd be another 15 minutes, but you cannot put a non-inverter model on a boat. And if you do, you choose to do that, but don't ever blame God or bad fortune when you lose your underwater metals that and they're all corroded and your prop is gone and your shafts are gone and your strut's gone and you've got a $10,000 bill. And don't say that life's not fair and things are not going well for you. You chose to put a non-marine model on your boat. You shall pay the price, and it's going to happen, okay, the way they're wired. There's huge pitfalls to, like, Canadian Tire inverters or chargers, the way they're wired. I can tell you why. The what is don't do it. If you choose to do it, buyer beware. You want to look for another thing that's really important when you're looking for an inverter is something that's true sine wave. Most of the things that we like to run on an inverter are inductive loads. There's two types of loads on a boat. Appliances. There's inductive and resistive loads. Resistive loads are a toaster, a heater. Those are resistive. It's a resistor. That's basically what it is. And it creates heat. An inductive load is a motorized load. So for example, a microwave is an inductive load. TVs are inductives. Blenders. Nespresso machine. I had a client bought three Nespresso machines in a row and returned them, and they were broken three times because he ran it off a modified sine wave inverter. Always blaming the Nespresso machine, bad quality of machine. Eventually, he kind of triggered that something must be wrong, right? What's the coincidence of having three bad Nespresso machines? And then we came on board, and we explained to him that you can't really run a Nespresso machine on a modified sine wave inverter. You also want to make sure that your inverter has low power draw, meaning at idle. So when it's on but not doing anything, you don't want it to run, take 5 amps. So you want to make sure that when it's there but not doing anything, it's not drawing a lot of power. Some inverters draw a lot of power just to be, I'm ready for you. Whenever you need to turn me on, I'm going to be ready, but to be ready, I'm going to charge you a lot. Some of them, just even recently, a few years ago, were drawing 5 amps on idle. 5 amps is insane. That's like saying, I might need to drive a car, and so I'm going to have someone, $75,000 a year, sitting and waiting for me to be chauffeured. Now, if you've got lots of money, it doesn't matter. But your fridge, a typical fridge on a typical boat, is maybe 5 amps, half duty cycle. So that's two refrigerators running off that inverter while it's just waiting for you to ask of it to do something. So make sure that you look at the idle draw of your inverter before you purchase one. The other thing too is you want to make sure that your inverter is efficient. So efficiency means it's about conversion rate. So when you go from 12 volts to 120, it's about a factor of 10, right? I mean, 12 goes into 120 10 times. That's like the difference between an American dollar and a Canadian dollar. Right now, the exchange rate is 1.3, right? It fluctuates, but there's an exchange rate. Now, that exchange rate, when you buy that dollar, you're not charged 1.3. There's a conversion to that exchange, right? The bank might charge you 0.2 on top of the 1.3, 0.02. Some inverters will tack on 35% to convert the power from AC to DC, or DC to AC. That's significant. A 35% conversion, the bank's charging us 2 to change. Modern inverters are 5. 4. So you can see that I have owners that sometimes change their inverters for the only reason that they use their inverter a lot. And by changing the inverter, they're going to save 30% of power on all their inverter loads. So when you shop for an inverter that's efficient. Also, because inverters are generally put close to the batteries, you want to have a remote control so that you can turn the inverter on or off. So you don't have that idle without actually going down in some bay, some engine room, somewhere where it's inconvenient for you to do that. You want always the ability of turning it on and off remotely. So remote control is really useful. And here are the popular models. By the way, I'm going to have this presentation put on my website. So at the end, if anyone's curious, we're going to have all of this as PDFs for some of you that want to have the content. But if you're installing an inverter, these are kind of the pitfalls you've got to look for. And there's a lot of that. And I would say in a given year, I do about 300 electrical audits a year. That's on top of the 600 boats that we actually do work on. And I would say 90%, a little probably higher, 95% of all inverters I've ever seen on a boat, and remember, I go on 300 boats a year myself. 95% of all inverters are not properly installed. And the simple reason is if you look at an inverter manual, It's like a book. And no man is gonna read a book like that. Because it's stupid. It's a waste of time. And they know better. And so what they look at that, they're like, well, it can't be that complicated. They look at the inverter box. It doesn't have all the parts to install the inverter in the box. Because they're not buying an inverter system, they're buying an inverter. And they go, let me just do it. Let me show you how I can just get it done without reading a manual. And oddly, it works, but all the safety features of the inverter are in the manual and don't come with the inverter. So these are common things that you're gonna see missing on your inverter installation. And if you have an inverter on your boat, I would be hard pressed to look at all of this and make sure that all of these things are done. And like I said, I probably see one out of 20 boats has a properly installed inverter. Because that's a lot of things to do. And all those things don't need to be there for the inverter to work. The problem is when the inverter, when something happens to the inverter and you go a little bit off-road, something goes sideways, what's going to happen to protect the inverter? And all these things matter. Also, some new inverter chargers now on top of it where needed is they're giving not only remote monitoring on a panel, but remote monitoring on a phone. So that's also convenient on the bigger boats or for people that are really gadgety into technology. All right, next, AGM batteries. Why AGM batteries? AGM batteries are absorbed glass mat batteries. What that means is they're all still lead acid batteries, okay? So lead acid batteries are lead acid batteries, and we're not talking about lithium batteries. We're talking about lead acid, and they really come in three flavors. Lead acid flooded, lead acid AGM, which is absorbed glass mat, and lead acid gel. I'm not gonna talk about gel, not that they're not great, but it's complicated. Most of us, 99% of us, are gonna go either flooded lead acid or AGM lead acid. When we repower boats or redo the battery system, we always try to educate owners into making a choice that's right for them for various reasons. And one of the main reasons why you should consider an AGM is that they have more battery, usable battery capacity, a factor of about 1.5 times than a flooded battery. They don't vent as much or practically limited. They're leak proof. They'll never ever. You could shoot it, you could drill through it, there's no water in it. They don't discharge as much, and they're perfect for deep cycle and starter applications. So it's a way better battery, hands down, than a flooded deep cycle. The downside is cost, right? I mean, obviously, if this was all positive, everyone would do that. The downside is cost, and the cost is a factor of two. Yeah, question?
Is it maintenance-free?
Absolutely maintenance-free. Absolutely. An AGM battery does not need your involvement. When I was attending a Nigel Calder talk 3 years ago, he was echoing exactly the same thing that I see out in the field. And he was saying that people have the best intentions when they buy a flooded deep cycle battery. They promise themselves that they don't need the AGM because they'll maintain their batteries and because they're good. They're gonna do it and they can follow a routine and look, honey, I saved us half the money and I will top off the batteries. The problem with flooded lead acid batteries is it really doesn't care how many times you did a good action. The one time that you forget to top it off when you should have will kill the battery. So that battery has no memory or any care that you got it perfect for the last 19 times. If the 19th time you don't top off the fluids and you expose the plates, that battery is going to be ruined. And it's not going to understand that you had a wedding this summer, that your daughter went to Europe and you decided to go traveling, that you got sick, that you went biking in Europe instead. Whatever it is that you come up as a reason for not being able to do the maintenance, or worse, that battery's really hard to reach and my back hurts, or I did three of the four, I did all the cells except the one that was hard to reach. One cell goes down, your battery bank goes down, and you have to change all your batteries. So unless you're a type of person that has great with routine, and there's some of us that are great with routine, and you follow, without exception, always a routine, then a flooded lead acid battery might be a good choice for you. But for a lot of us, life gets in the way, you don't maintain the battery, and then the flooded lead acid battery becomes the most expensive battery because the age of the battery that you predicted you were gonna have was shortened because you killed it. So that's why Nigel and I recommend AGM batteries. Did you have a question? No.
What is the life expectancy?
Life expectancy is a function of cycles, and cycles is a function of depth of discharge. So you always have a trade-off where the battery is how deep you bring it down, and how deep you bring it down, and how quickly you charge it back again is really what's going to define. So a lead-acid battery flooded is about 300 cycles at 50%. An AGM battery at 50% is 450 cycles, so about 50% more. And AGM batteries are probably gonna last, flooded batteries depend, these are ranges, okay? There's exceptions. 5 to 7 for flooded, probably 6 to 9, 10 for AGM. But if, for example, on my boat, when I had flooded, I bought my boat had flooded batteries, but I babied them. Like, I went crazy. They lasted 10 years. But I'm crazy about my electrical system, right? I'm obsessive compulsive about my electrical system.
Like every month you check.
I check them, I do everything. Because that's my business. I love that. But for normal owners, 5 to 7 years is average for flooded. AGM a little bit more. What I wanna say here is that when you buy a AGM battery or any sort of battery, you can buy a battery in all different shapes and sizes. And here you can buy them in L16, group 24, group 27. You can buy them 4D, slimline. So you can mix and match battery size, battery chemistry, and battery manufacture. So most manufacturers will do all different types of battery chemistries and all different battery types or sizes. So you can buy an 8D AGM from East Pendeca. You can buy an 8D flooded deep cycle from East Pendeca. You can buy, you know, any sort of combination. All the big manufacturers like US Battery, Odyssey, Discovery, all those big companies are going to have multiple batteries in their lineup. And I guess if you're going to put AGM batteries, you need to make sure you have an AGM compatible charger. That's a really big one. And if you're also going to put AGM batteries, make sure within a house bank, all those house batteries have to be AGM. You can't have two flooded deep cycles and say, oh yeah, I'm gonna add AGM, I want more capacity, and I'm gonna put two other AGM batteries on board. The next thing I wanna talk about is, we talked about batteries, we talked about a battery monitor, we talked about an inverter charger. Chargers are important, and especially smart chargers, because they're gonna reduce the amount of time it takes you to recharge your batteries. And they can be left on permanently, meaning the battery charger will automatically phase out and give exactly what the battery needs, so it never overcharges the battery, even if the battery charger is left on all the time, which is something you can't say about ferro-resonant chargers. And if you have the right rate of charge, i.e. right rate of charge is about, we'll talk about it, about 10% of capacity for the battery bank, meaning if you have four golf cart batteries in a 12-volt battery bank, let's say it's 440 amp hours, you need about 44 amps of charge rate as a minimum to make sure that that battery life meets what you would expect. So these are sort of things that you need to make sure when you buy a battery charger. Make sure that it's a battery charger that will actually allow you to choose the battery type. So maybe you have flooded today, but eventually you want to do AGM, right? That'd be nice to have. Really useful is also to have it temperature compensated, meaning battery voltage changes depending on what the temperature of the battery is. And whatever you think about a battery voltage in your mind, these numbers that may mean something like 14.4, 13.3, 13.8, 12.6, 12.8, 12.2, all those numbers are common voltages that mean like bulk charging, float charging, full battery, 50%. All those numbers are actually at 77 degrees Fahrenheit. And as soon as the battery gets colder, those numbers are different, and it's warmer, they're different. So if you have a temperature compensated battery charger, you might have a battery that's 55 degrees Fahrenheit and a float voltage is not 13.3 anymore, it's 13.7, right? So it's gonna charge the battery higher by 0.4 volts because the battery's colder. So temperature compensated battery charging is a really good thing to extend your battery life. And these are all the different things that you should look for when you're actually installing a battery charger. Probably the biggest one that I see miss is not fusing the leads on a battery charger. That's commonly missed. Making sure the battery charger is connected to the batteries. To the batteries, not at the switch, not at the panel. Don't take shortcuts. It's not worth it. There's a lot of pitfalls to shortcut. Go directly to the battery. And make sure that the AC breaker is able to handle bulk charging for that battery charger. I see owners sometimes increase the battery charger, the batteries were full, the charger's not working at full capacity. They leave, they're happy. Oh look, it's on. But it's on and not drawing a lot. They go out for a cruise, they go back, now they connect to shore power, the batteries are empty, the charger goes to bulk, full capacity, now the breaker trips, right? Why? Because now they're using the charger at full capacity. A charger doesn't draw the same thing regardless if it's working at full capacity or not. The draw on the AC system is going to be a function of how much the batteries are depleted. So you want to always make sure that your battery charger is sized, or your battery charger AC breaker is sized to handle the maximum current draw that the charger is going to need to recharge the batteries at full capacity. And if you have flooded batteries or deep cycle or AGM, make sure that it's set to the right battery type. That's commonly missed. Those dip switches are easy to change, and I often go on board boats and it's gonna be set for flooded and they have AGM, or they set it to, they had AGM but they knocked it to flooded, or vice versa. So make sure that if you have a battery charger on your boat, make sure that the settings on the charger are set properly. And also, as your battery banks get bigger and bigger, it's gonna be challenging to get that 10% of charge rate from one charger, because the battery banks are getting larger and larger. And so what you can do is you can stack chargers. And on some boats, we have three of those chargers side by side to reduce the genset runtime. So an owner might have a 1200 amp hour battery bank and he'll have 300 amps of charging going in the batteries. And so the owner does that as a way to reduce the genset runtime. I've had owners that ran their batteries for the genset for 8 hours a day to recharge their batteries. And drove them crazy, right? Because they don't need AC for that long, they were just doing it to recharge their batteries. So what you can do by stacking chargers, you can take that maybe 100 amp charge rate, bring it to 300 amps. So if you're earning three times the income that you did before, you only have to do it a third of the time. So now your genset runtime thing, 8 hours, is suddenly 2.5 hours. Well, that's a dramatic difference in terms of genset lifetime, because you're running the genset loaded, right? It's not bothering you as much. So stacking chargers is a really popular thing. One of the things that we've been, and it's funny, I was just talking to a fellow in the booth that has, for example, Meridian 490. We did another charger on his boat last year, so we stacked some chargers. And he's like, Jeff, I boat with a lot of sailboaters, and we like to be quiet. So we have a genset, but we don't like running it. We only run it when we need to run our AC appliances, but we don't want to run our genset more than we have to recharge the batteries. We'll recharge our batteries while we're doing other things, but the moment I'm not running the stovetop or I'm not doing something that's AC like a water maker, I don't want to recharge my batteries with my genset via battery charger. And so he came to me and he said, I want to recharge my batteries with solar. And so what we're seeing nowadays is we're seeing a lot of power boaters that have gensets, but they want to be out there quiet. And so this owner is putting a 1,000-watt array on top of his Bimini. And it sounds a lot, but it's actually not that uncommon anymore. And so he's going to be getting about 250 amp hours a day from this solar array. So that's going to run his fridges, run pretty much everything on his boat in perpetuity whenever he's away from dock. And so when we size solar panels, some people said to me, I had another lady today, she has a small little fishing boat, and she says, Jeff, I want to be able to have my boat on a mooring and keep my batteries topped off, so when I come on board and we row to our boat and then we take off, the batteries are topped off, right? Because I can't connect. Some other owners say, Jeff, and I had another owner, he had an Album 28, and he said to me just earlier, he said, Jeff, I want offset refrigeration. I remember what it was like boating without refrigeration, and now that I have refrigeration, I want offset refrigeration. So that's another one. Common people say, they say, Jeff, I'm 2 days in Anchorage, I want to stay another day, right? Or what I did on my boat, I said, in case the zombie apocalypse happens, I want to be on my boat in perpetuity forever. And so I have daily amp hour demand. So in the summer for 6 months, 5 months of the year, I never connect to shore power. I have all the power I need, and I don't even need to run an alternator. I don't need anything. I can stay out. I can stay at Prito if I want for 6 months, and I have all the power I need from solar. So you can have all that range, right, of what you're going to do with solar. And what's interesting about these flexible solar panels is you can mount them. They come with peel and stick, so you can actually mount them on hardtops. You can sew them onto canvas with zippers, with Bimini, with Velcro. You can use grommets. I have one of my team members, she's got a Bayliner with a sun deck, and instead of the cushions up front, she put one of those solar panels with grommets, and she just put one solar panel right on the sun deck, and she uses it to recharge her batteries. So there's various ways of mounting these solar panels depending on your boat. I mentioned that a little earlier. Basically, the shorthand formula is that wattage divided by 4 is what you're going to get in terms of amp hours. So if you have a 100-watt solar panel, you're going to get a daily amp hour output of 25 amp hours. Or you could say, Jeff, my fridge takes 60 amp hours a day. How much do I need for solar? You do 60 times 4. Instead of dividing, you get 240 watts. And so now you're looking for an array that's going to give you about 240 watts. And this is in BC in the summer between May and September. Of course, in the wintertime, when it's the dead of winter and it's raining torrential downpours in December, you're not going to get a factor of 4. But in the summer, when most of us are boating, a factor of 4 is very realistic. And that's actually, I had a client today came by, he has a Kamano. His ratio when his sun is really good, it's a factor of 2.7, right? So he's actually getting, instead of getting 100 watts divided by 4, it's 100 divided by 2.7. So he's getting 40 amp hours a day from that array, which is pretty significant, right? So he has a 270-watt array, and he's getting over 100 amp hours a day when it's sunny. Right, so way better than 4. The 4 is the conservative value. 3 is the optimistic, right? 2.7 is just too good to be true. And 4 is really what you're going to get, and maybe worst case, factor of 5. So if you're going to have solar panels on your boat, make sure that you pair with an efficient MPPT. What that means is, a little bit like that inverter I was talking about before, you know how I said some of them take 35% to convert AC, DC to AC? Some converters, the PWMs, are going to take 20% to convert. So if you have a 100-watt solar panel, you effectively have an 80-watt solar panel just to convert the sun power to a 12-volt voltage that your batteries need. So really good, efficient MPPTs are going to be like 3%. So you're only going to lose about 3% to convert that voltage that comes out from the solar panel to the battery voltage that your batteries need. Make sure you wire to minimize the voltage drop. That means don't cheap out and put small little wires that are going to basically block the current coming into your batteries, right? So don't create weak points. Try to harness all that energy, right, coming from the solar panels to go back to your batteries, because the solar panels proportionally are way more money than the wiring you're going to put in, right? Way, way more money. And so it's better to choose a little bit bigger wire so that you actually are able to harness all the power. And a little bit like the battery charger I was talking about, make sure that the panels are connected at the battery, not at the switch. I can't go in too much into the why, but that the what is very important. Do not deviate from that rule. Yes, you had a question?
Yes, does there have to be a regulator?
Yeah, and that a regulator is a controller. Yes, and that's called an MPPT. Yeah, absolutely, because a solar panel might be outputting only 8 volts, might be outputting 22 volts, right? Like, who knows what the sun's going to produce? And the sun is really a function of the number of cells in that panel. Every cell has a certain voltage, and they're all in series within a panel. And so the panel might be outputting 36 volts, 22 volts, 18 volts, 8 volts. Your batteries want not just 12. They want the voltage to vary depending on how full they are, right? So they might want to go all the way to 14.4 if they're flooded, or 14.6 if it's AGM. So you want to make sure that you have a controller that's charging the batteries as quickly as possible, but also pulling back. If your batteries are full, the controller has to know that and needs to stop charging the batteries, right? So you cannot connect solar panels directly to your batteries. You need a controller, either PWM or MPPT. But I don't believe it's a real choice. In my opinion, I strongly suggest that you buy an MPPT controller and not a PWM. The next thing I want to talk about here is what's called a ethanol, or actually, that's a typo. It's a methanol fuel cell. And what it is, it's basically a battery charger. It's a battery charger that's powered via methanol, meaning that you don't need to be connected to AC shore power. You don't need to be connected or have your generator running. You don't need the alternator running. You can have this device, and this device will actually allow you to recharge your batteries with no noise, because it's 22 decibels, no vibration, no smoke. And so for some of us that don't have room to put a generator on board, or have a generator that's kind of giving us a lot of grief and we don't want to repair it, or we repair it too often and we just want to give up on it, I've had a lot of owners where we come on board, we remove the generator, and we install a fuel cell instead. And it's a really easy way for you to recharge your batteries without any of the drawbacks of a generator. And basically what it is, because remember, batteries, what do batteries do? Batteries store energy, but at one point you got to refill that energy, right? It's just a storage system. How are you going to get power back into the batteries, right? Now, if you're just doing a day trip, you leave the dock, come back, that's easy. You'll be back connected to shore power, you run your charger. But what if you're out there for an extended period of time? You're out there for a week, 2 weeks. How are you going to keep on having your batteries topped off without running the engine as often as you want? Maybe you like to stay at Anchorage for 2-3 days. So a fuel cell is the way to go. They come in all different sizes. Like, basically, and that again is another typo, my apologies. It should be 80 amp hours, 140 amp hours, or 210 amp hours a day. That's the output that you're going to get from that. Most people end up choosing the 140. You carry extra fuel on board because the fuel is not that readily available. I mean, you can find it in channelries and whatnot, but you're not going to find it in, Refuge Cove in Desolation Sound. So what I do is most of my owners use about 3 fuel cartridges a year, $80 in fuel. I do the same. So what I have is I have on my boat 3 fuel cartridges. So whenever I have one connected to the unit, when I'm done one, pop it out. I have then two backup, put the other one. Next time I'm in town, go back, get another one. So I've got always two cartridges as backup. And that's a way for me to never have to worry about. Like, I like cruising where there's nobody. I'm not that social when I boat. I like to be alone somewhere. And so I'm not going to be running. I'm not going to be in a place in front of Sydney where I can just go, or Nanaimo or Campbell River, where I can just go to a channelry and buy the fuel. I'm going to be in some remote anchorage, someplace, all by myself. And if I run out of fuel, I just like, no problem, take another fuel cartridge and put it in. And the fact that I only use three cartridges a year means that I'm not worried about missing fuel too often, because I've got all the fuel I need for a whole year on my boat. Yeah, go ahead. Yes, it is. It's not like gasoline. You can actually store it inside the boat. It'd be like cooking fuel, right? I mean, of course it's flammable, but it's not gasoline where it actually evaporates and then it goes everywhere. It's explosive, okay? So it is flammable, but it does not, it's not a risk of explosion like a gasoline. You can't store gasoline in your cabin. So these are all different things that you want to make sure if you install one. The interesting thing is it actually outputs distilled water. That's the output. And we normally, on some boats where there's not a lot of space or the boats are dry bilges, we'll have it come to a little water bottle, you know, bike water bottle. And then that water bottle goes back to retopping your batteries, because your batteries want distilled water and distilled water only. So you've got distilled water to top off your flooded lead acid batteries. An external regulator is basically a brain for an alternator, and it converts your alternator to be a smart three-phase charging system. And why you want that is you're pretty much going to increase your alternator output by 50% by just putting one of these devices on board. So if you're a sailboater and you don't have a methanol fuel cell, you don't have solar panels, and you're running your alternator at idle under no load to recharge your batteries, or you're sailing but you're running your alternator for 1 hour when you leave the anchorage, another hour maybe when you come back, and you want to reduce your engine runtime, the way to do that is with an external regulator. Make sure that when you buy an external regulator, you have one that allows for different battery chemistries, because one day you might go to AGM, so that's nice. The modern day ones allow for different charge profiles, so you can actually say, I want my absorption voltage to be this, I want my bulk or absorption time to be this, I want, you can tweak everything you want, and it's kind of nice depending on sort of the batteries you're going to get over time. What's also really nice, and I had a question yesterday when I did another presentation, was, will that help protect my alternator? Yes, it will make it run harder, but the one advantage is with an alternator temperature sensor, as the alternator is getting hot, the external regulator is going to know that, and it's actually going to pull back. It's actually going to run the alternator less hot. So it's going to say, you know what, you're getting a little bit too warm, you're working too hard, the engine room is too hot, let's reduce the amount of current that the alternator is producing so it doesn't heat up as much. So it's a good way of extending alternator life, because now you're monitoring temperatures on the alternators, and alternators generally die because they're overheated. It's really a horrible place to be. An alternator on a boat, it's a deadly place. The engine rooms get so much hotter than in cars, and they're normally converted car alternators. They might be ignition protected, but they're designed predominantly for cars, and the cooling in an alternator is never sufficient or really sufficient considering what we ask of them to do, because they're really working hard to recharge the batteries. When you're going to change that regulator, make sure that you look at the alternator wire, because now suddenly you're increasing the output by about 50%. And if you're increasing the output of 50%, the wire from your alternator to wherever it's going is probably undersized, right? They did not wire the alternator for all permutations that you could ever envision. So if you change your alternator and you put a bigger one in, you have to probably change the alternator wire size. If you have an alternator and you put an external regulator and now the alternator outputs 50% more, you need to change the wire size. I can't stress enough, and I see this time and time again, and I'm a big stickler for this, if you follow the manual, you'll do it properly. What generally happens is someone thinks they're smarter than the manual. Now, there's nothing wrong if you're an electrical engineer in marine and you've done this thousands of times, you might be able to do something better than anyone else. It's possible. But remember, if you're a do-it-yourself guy and you've done your own boat, the person writing the manual is not telling you why you need to do something. If they told you why, you'd probably do it. But they're not telling you the why because they want you to read the manual, right? Because if they told you why, the manual wouldn't be a manual anymore, it'd be a book. So they just tell you what. So trust me when I say follow the manual, because I see it all the time. People look at the manual and they think that the people that wrote the manual are stupid. Well, first of all, they don't see them, so it's easy to tell them they're stupid. And then they decide how to find shortcuts, because we're all driven to find shortcuts in life. But the problem is taking a shortcut without being an expert has tons of pitfalls. And I can't tell you how many external regulators are not actually doing anything that the external regulator was supposed to do because the owner decided to install it his way. And they said, oh, well, what's that? That's just stupid. And I'm going to do it my way. But what they don't understand is that the person who wrote the manual did never tell them the why, because the manual would be too big. So please, if you're going to do that, I highly encourage you, if you want to get all the benefits from an external regulator, don't take shortcuts and follow it to the letter. If you do, you're really going to reap the benefits of an external regulator. If you don't, you're going to blame the external regulator for not being useful. And you're going to complain that you wasted your money on an external regulator. Because rarely do people ever blame themselves, right? I mean, the blame always goes somewhere else. And nobody's there to defend the external regulator, so you're just going to blame the external regulator. But it's not the external regulator that's a problem, it's the installation. So please follow the directions. All right, here's another thing that's really interesting. And this is something that's quite common. Back in the day, there was no easy, efficient way to distribute alternator output to multiple battery banks. And so boat builders were forced to choose between convenience and efficiency. And because boat owners change and boat owners forget instructions because we do other things than running a boat, a lot of boat owners chose convenience over efficiency. So I commonly go on a boat and the owner's saying to me, Jeff, my alternator just doesn't do anything for me. I run and I get to my destination after 8 hours and my batteries are barely charged. Well, that's because they have what's called a diode combiner, and the boat builder decided to give them this diode combiner as a way to give them convenience over efficiency. A diode combiner is going to make you lose about 70% of your alternator output so that your alternator can go into multiple places without you having to dial it in, right, with switches. 70%. You make $100,000, you're like, I've got two bank accounts, Jeff. I want you to distribute my money evenly. And in doing so, I'm willing to give up $70,000 of my income so that you balance wherever the money needs to go. It's crazy, right? And trust me, so many boats have diode combiners on board. Now, back in the day, that was the only choice. People did it. They had no other choice. But modern day alternator output distributions, and they're called FETs, will do it with only 3%, 2%, 70% versus 2. So one of the most popular things we do for boat owners is take out a diode combiner and put in a modern day equivalent so that the alternator, all of it, is able to be distributed to multiple battery banks. Because an alternator is a single output device. This is one of the models we commonly use, this Argo FET from Victron. And if you're gonna put one in, you see this 3% is a good target. Make sure also now suddenly the wire size needs to be increased, right? Because now, before when they did your system, they thought that you were only gonna get 70% of alternator output. So the wire size looked puny, they're puny because most of that alternator output was lost in heat to divide the alternator to multiple battery banks. A battery combiner is similar, but a battery combiner is not the same thing. And that's a device that allows your batteries to automatically be put in parallel whenever there's a charging voltage. And so for people that don't have diode combiners, this is another way of having one alternator charge multiple battery banks. Make sure when you choose one for the right amperage. Popular models are Blue Seas ACR, which stands for Automatic Combiner Relay, or BEP has a model and they call it VSR, Voltage Sensor Relay. Ultimately, they're both relays. Those are both marketing terms. What it is a solenoid that is digitally activated whenever there's a charging voltage, and whenever the charging voltage disappears, the circuit opens. Opens means bad, close means good. So make sure when you install one that you put a fuse on both ends of the circuit, and that's really important. Also, connect at the batteries, not the switch. You always, always follow that advice. You're curious why, you're that type of person, you always need to understand why you're doing something. Ask me after the class, I'll tell you why. But if you just want to know the Cole Notes version, just what do I need to do? Always connect to the batteries, black and white. The last thing on the list is a galvanic isolator. And a galvanic isolator is a really inexpensive way for you to protect your boats against galvanic corrosion from being connected to shore power connection in a marina with other boats around you. And yes, there are better products out there, but they're way more money, way heavier. Like this weighs 10 pounds. An isolation transformer is $1,500, weighs 300 pounds. This weighs 10 pounds, costs $300. This is takes an hour to install. An isolation transformer takes a day, 2 days, 3 days, depending. Yes? Yeah, exactly. Every single boater, black and white, I mean, there's not a lot of black and white rules in this world, that doesn't have an isolation transformer wants one of these. This is a way for you to isolate yourself from bad neighbors. I have boat owners that had, being in business for 10 years now, boat owner leaves one marina, no problem with zincs, takes off, is moved to another marina. Nothing's changed in the boat. I mean, moving the boat hasn't changed the boat. Could happen, but it's unlikely. Suddenly the zincs go from being changed once a year to 3 months. What happened? Someone else in that marina has bad AC wiring, bad protection, and what they're doing is they're using your boats to protect their boats. So having a perfect boat doesn't save you from a bad neighbor. The bad neighbor is going to use your boat to make their boat better. They're going to draw everyone down with them. And so a galvanic isolator is a way to isolate yourself from bad neighbors. Yes, an isolation transformer is much better, but again, because it weighs 250 pounds and it's this big and it's expensive to put in, all the big boats have isolation transformer from 50 feet onwards. They all do. They have to. But smaller than that, it becomes an arbitrary decision for the boat builder. And so a lot of us in the 20, 30, 40 foot range, especially sailboaters, are not going to have it. And so if you don't have a galvanic isolator, highly recommend getting one. Make sure you buy it for the amperage of your shore power. Is it a 30 amp shore power, a 50 amp shore power? And a really important point here is make sure it's a fail-safe model, meaning if it ever shorts because of lightning or whatever, it's not going to be an open circuit. It's going to be a closed circuit. And I know it's always confusing. Open sounds bad, but you always want it to be a closed circuit, meaning your grounding wire is still there. So they're a little bit more money, but they're worth it because you don't have to check them as often. And this is how you install it. It's actually pretty easy to install. It doesn't take a lot of time, maybe an hour, 2 hours. It's pretty straightforward, and it works. So that's basically the presentation. And I'm not sure if there's someone else, but I'm going to open the floor to questions in the meantime. Yeah, go ahead. Yeah, that's a really good device, by the way. I really like echo chargers. An echo charger is a good marketing term because what it says is an echo is a reflection of something, right? And what that means is you're able to have your alternator connected to your house batteries, which you should. I think that's a great way to do it. That's not, by the way, how a boat is normally wired because it takes more time to do it. And so boat builders are cost conscious and they'll take the easy way out. But you should have your alternator output go to your house. And then what you want to do is if you want to send your house, some of the voltage from your house to your engine battery, you'll send some of it through an echo. And it's not a bi-directional device. It only will send one way. And so the echo charge from Xantrex is only 15 amps, which is plenty. So it's going to send up to 15 amps to the engine battery. I really like that device. Big fan of that. Yes, go ahead.
What's the benefit?
Oh, sorry, there's a question of an echo charge? Well, it's one alternator. An alternator has a single output. So you connected the house. How is your engine battery going to get a charge while you're underway? So now you have one alternator charging two things.
You never have to work your switch.
That's the big thing because, yeah, because remember, your electrical system is not going to be reliable because of you. You're the problem. If we weren't on boats, electrical systems would be amazing. Yes, question. About $550 for a Balmar M614 is what you're going to get. Yeah, definitely worth it. No, that's just the device. No. Does anything cost less than a boat buck? Like, yeah, go ahead. Yeah, it will, absolutely. Way better at idle. An external regulator? Yes, it will do that. It will. I'm having a hard time hearing you, but I'll talk the question in the back. Another quick question?
How much is a galvanic isolator?
About a galvanic isolator is around $300 for a non-fail-safe. Fail-safe is around $450. Yeah, about $450.
Are you selling them?
Yeah, of course. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. All right. I'm out of your way.